U.S. Army soldier since 1977. How about you?
76? I don't think anyone knows more about KISS than I do.
No, actually, I'm a former.
I'm not sure I like the tone of your voice.
Well, throw down, if that's what you want.
Then Gene Simmons, special effects mentor.
Amazo the Magician. What high school did Paul Stanley go to?
New York High School of Music. Paul and Gene's band before KISS.
Wicked Lester. What year did KISS appear on the Jim Neighbors Halloween special?
Quick question. It was Paul Lynde, and it was 1975. Now recite the magazine ad that brought Peter Criss to Paul and Gene's attention.
Drummer willing to do anything to make it. Rolling Stone, October 1972.
Except for rock and roll.
To the show!
Kiss Army!
Is so exciting. We can live on eternally.
You drive us wild, we'll drive you crazy. You keep on saying you'll be mine for a while. You're looking fancy and I like your style.
The band will never stop because the fans own the band.
You show us everything you got.
Our shows are about joy.
It's live by KISS.
I'm really looking forward to the future.
We're all in this together. The band deserves to live on because the band is bigger than we are.
It's going to be the best concert you've ever seen.
Keep going, boys. We love you.
I can't wait to see it.
Pildar, verið velkomnir í fjörðin.
Hakkaðir fyrir sömu leiðis.
Og þessum dásamlega degi, afmælisdagur Elvis Presley, þið við tökum upp. Afmælisdagur David Bowie. Afmælisdagur Robbie Krieger. Afmælisdagur Karl Örvars. Afmælisdagur pappas Jakobs Frímanns Magnússonar.
Nú átti að hafa hann Frímann.
Já, já, Frímann sjálfur. Nei, ja. Nei, Magnús sjálfur.
Magnús minnaði. Hvernig var hægt að klúra þessu,
já? Já, já, þú þetta aftur það.
Maggi Koppa,
sko. Og síðast er ekki síðast afmælisdagur.
Já, það eru hérna systraböðn.
Systraböðn, starfháður.
Já, það eru afmælið.
Já, já, já. Hún er ekki reyðið upp á göttur í.
Nei, það ekki, en það líka Nei, voru ekki rífinu på götunni En það var líka 45 ára afmæli hérna, tónleikana sem Kiss heldur 8. janúar 1978
Já
Nei, það þetta 46 ára afmæli
Já,
Já það þetta þannig En það var sold out, 1785
Þeir voru í vikitt lestir og gerðu þennan plötusamning og svona Hvað tók við framhaldi? Gaman að heyra þetta, heyriði.
We had a record contract. There was a group called Wicked Lester with five guys in it. We recorded the album at Electric Lady and Epic Records bought it. And we looked at each other and went, this isn't right. We knew we belonged together, although he hated me when we first met. Oh, boy.
I still you, have days.
Hopefully that's gone. No, I was delusional. So we tried to fire the other three guys, and they said, we're not leaving. We're part of the record contract, and we're sticking by it. So we said, okay, then we're quitting the band, because it wasn't right. Mm. I don't know how we knew. We'd record, come out of there. It was morning. People were exhausted.
We would do
Is that the music you want to make? That's by the way, that was one of the songs. It ain't Led Zeppelin. It's not good, is it? We're going, nope, it's not. And we gotta start again. It's not right. Even though we had a record deal.
And it wasn't intellectualized, it wasn't us going, well, if we do this. No, we have to do this. It's in our blood. It's in our soul. We have to be Kiss. Once we knew we weren't Wicked Lester, we knew we were Kiss.
Heyrið þetta. En sko, þarna eru náttúrulega bara að tala sko, hvað þeir hafa að segja hérna, Peter og Ace, okkar menn?
Já, það rugglega fallið.
You can never finish the Kiss story without discussing or saying the unsaid. Which is Ace and Peter, the two original guys who started with us, were every bit as important. And you have to give kudos and recognition and respect and admiration and love to Ace and Peter for helping us start the band. Not everybody has the DNA to run a marathon and to last for 50 years. Mm. If you look at any band that's been around for half a century, and there you can count them on the hand, the chances are pretty good you're not going to have original members. You can't do this technology and all that stuff without recognizing the fact that Ace and Peter helped us in ways that other people couldn't have.
We couldn't have started this without them, and we couldn't be here today with them. And for us, it was Kiss is more important than any individual member. And I'm the first to say, look, I'm damn good at what I do, but I know that there's somebody else out there who could do what I do, who could pick up the flag and run with it, who would believe in it as much as I do. Well, Tommy's been with us in the band over 20 years, and Eric's played with us off and on for close to 30. So in that way, the band can go on forever, and we're not going anywhere.
Sko, þarna náttúrulega kemur koma þér inn á það 2015 nóvember síðastliðin 2023.
It started in the early 1970s. There was a radio station in Terre Haute, Indiana. That wouldn't play Kiss. Young guy, because it just takes one young person with a little bit of balls and independence to make things happen. Bill Starkey called the radio station and said, if you don't play Kiss, and he gave them a time, he said, we will surround your radio station. They thought it was a joke. Until the station was surrounded and they played Kiss. That was the start of the Kiss Army. And you are the Kiss Army 2023.
We'll be right back.
Finally, welcome to Kiss Army Iceland podcast again, Mr. Starkey.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
How are you? Happy New Year.
Well, I'm well, thank you. Happy New Year to you too. How's the volcano?
It's pretty silent at the moment, but we never know.
It's sleeping.
Okay.
It's sleeping.
So, Mr. Starkey, again, welcome to the show, and we welcome you always, of course. You saw, of course, you got the sweater on, right on.
I have to.
Yeah, of course.
Of course.
How was your last Kiss concert in Indianapolis?
Very good. I really had a good time. I had the best seats I ever had. I was in the second row. Mm-hmm. I was really impressed. I was looking to see if, you know, you hear all this stuff about the lip syncing and all that, and I didn't see it. And I could be just as critical as anybody. So I thought it was well done. It was a fitting end for Indiana. And, of course, it never hurts when they talk about you twice in the same day. So mm-hmm.
Yeah, we just played that earlier.
Yeah, that was not, I wasn't expecting that. So, I was given a plaque by some fans.
Oh, nice.
Oh, nice. A tribute to co-founder of the Kiss Army. All
yes.
Right. Established November 21st, 1975.
Uh-huh.
Indiana. Okay, wow.
yeah.
That was nice. So.
Okay.
But how many shows did you see from this during this last tour with Kiss?
This was the only one. This one.
Okay.
I hadn't seen the band since 2012 in Chicago.
Oh wow! Oh, okay, that's a long time.
Long time. And the only reason I was at this one was because a friend of mine decided he wanted me to go, so he paid for my.
Okay.
I said, yeah, in that case, I'll go. Because they're expensive, mm-hmm. especially second row,
yeah.
you know.
Yeah.
And I went with him as his guest, and it was a wonderful gesture, and that was it for me. You know, I mean, you know, you can go on YouTube and see a lot of the stuff on the shows and all that, and the shows aren't that much different,
no.
but I'm and being there live was just a lot more fun. Mm-hmm. I thought the visuals were great, the colors, the video that was in the background. It was well done.
Okay.
Okay. I mean, are there any special reasons for that you have not seen any concerts since 2012, you said?
I mean, I've not seen Kiss since 2012.
Yeah. So I mean,
yeah, I've seen all the other. I've seen.
Yeah, yeah.
But is there any reason for that?
The last time was in 2012. Was Tommy Thayer got me the tickets, and Tommy was really nice, and he mentioned to me that he could get me in, and matter of fact, he got me into three shows that year. And Cincinnati, Indianapolis, and Chicago, and that was all in 2012. And Chicago was the last of those three.
Mm.
And you know, it was something that not everybody gets to do. So I took him up on the offer, and that's what it was.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Backstage yeah. passes too.
Mm. Yeah.
Nice.
Oh, nice.
Okay.
Yeah, it was nice of him.
But Paul, did he know about you in the crowd in Indianapolis? Or?
I think, here's what I think happened is the gentleman that made the plaque gave the plaque to them backstage early in the morning. And he had contacted Doc McGee and said that he thought it would be kind of cool if the band presented me the plaque. Mm. Probably during the sound check when it's a lot less, you know, congested.
Mm-hmm.
So if you look at the video, I think Paul didn't necessarily think that I was going to be there during the sound check. So I was the one that yelled out when he said the Kiss Army was started by, and I said, Bill Starkey. Some other people said it along with me, and then I think, you know, I think he realized I was there. And I liked his funny comment. He called me an icon. And then the funny part was he says, I can't believe you're here. So, you know, it's neither here nor there. I mean, there's been times that I've just not been able to go to a lot of shows. And that's just, you know, like the Kiss cruises are very popular. I've never been on one because it always happens when I'm at school. Mm-hmm. So that's why. But yeah, I think Paul knew I was there because I think he probably saw the plaque. Mm. But I mean, I will say this to brag to all three of you. A lot of people were disappointed that nobody was mentioned at any of the shows.
Yes.
But I was mentioned.
Yeah.
We just talked
about. I mean, no Bill of Coin, no past members.
Yeah.
So I'm very proud of that. And I thank Paul for that, that he gave me that much because he didn't have to. And so, yeah, I'm going to brag about that for a long time. That,
of course.
You know,
of course.
Nobody else was thanked, not even Madison Square Garden, but me. So, you know.
Exactly. We just talked about it earlier during this show that the interview, actually two of them, Bruce Kulick did recently. Did you see that?
Yes. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So he finally is speaking up loud about his feelings towards the band.
Yeah, well, I don't know if it's a feelings towards the band. I think he felt that there should have been something at the end. Mm-hmm. And I understand that. And, you know, he's a wonderful person, a class act. I've always enjoyed doing expos with him. I'm glad he spoke up. But, you know, it's Paul's band, or at least I think Paul's makes the last word, or he has the last decision. Mm-hmm. And if you went to the show thinking something else was going to happen, I don't have any sympathy for you because I didn't think anything was going to happen. Even, I think when Doc McGee made the comments about saying that Kiss wasn't a jam band,
yeah.
I think that kind of told me that they're not going to do anything like that on stage. And like I said, that's why I don't feel upset for people that were upset the fact that they expected more of the show. I mean, Bruce's point was there's more to Kistry than what they did, and he's truly right. But how would you put that into a show? I mean, mm-hmm. when Kiss did their A&E documentary, they were lucky to squeeze it into 2 hours. I mean, to me, the past of the whole history of the band, I don't know how you could put that all together. And you know, the Kiss show is scripted, and it's scripted very well.
Yeah.
And I don't see how they could have done anything. But I guess since maybe I'm a Paul Stanley guy now, not that I always haven't been, if you don't play by the rules and you can't do what needs to be done for it to come off well, then I'm sorry you can't be in the show. Here's the thing with Bruce. How would you guys feel if Bruce was there and other people weren't? Yeah. Then it's kind of half done, right?
Yep.
Unless you can get everybody there, or at least as many people as possible, then it's just not going to work.
But I think like Ace and Peter, they just didn't get the invitation.
I think that, I don't know. I'm not going to get into an argument about whether or not they did or they didn't. But you got to admit, I don't think Ace did himself a lot of favors.
No.
No.
And you know, and I can see Paul's point of view there. You know, I mean, if I'm going to have to put up with that, let's just do the show and we're done.
Mm-hmm.
But see, I don't think Kiss is done anyway. I mean, as far as touring with the makeup, yes, and a tour, but I don't think they're done. I think that they'll do some things for the fans, and then maybe then they can encompass all these other things. But how would it have been if, like, Bruce showed and Peter showed and Ace didn't show? Mm-hmm. Or Ace showed and Peter showed and Bruce didn't show? You know what I mean? Or mm-hmm. And some people want Vinny. So mm-hmm. how are you going to get all four of them there to please everybody? I mean, somebody's always going to say, well, they left out this person. They left out that. So you know what? It's easier to say, thanks to the fan club guy.
Okay, yeah. Yeah. Okay. So what you're saying is that, I mean, all of them or none of them. That's your
pretty
point.
Pretty much.
Yeah, yeah.
And I said, you guys agree with me, Ace probably wasn't making things any better for himself.
No, well, not really.
I really never believed, and when I saw them in Indianapolis, I knew that that was pretty much what everybody in New York were going to see. So I didn't really think that anything was going to do anything any different. You know, other than, you know, maybe they could have showed a video montage or something. There was always a possibility of that, but I don't know. But you know what? I was disappointed during the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame ceremony that they didn't play together then. But I also understand why they didn't play. Mm-hmm. But you can always take that chance, get up there, and, you know, if somebody messes up, they mess up. But, you know, just make sure you don't mess up. Mm-hmm. So, I don't know. Maybe it's because the Kiss Unplugged thing went so well that we fans hold out that hope that if they did something like that again spontaneously, everything would fall into place, just like it did on the Kiss Unplugged MTV thing. Mm. And it just, you know, so like I said, I don't have any bad feelings about any of it. I'm glad Bruce spoke up, and he should speak up, because, you know, he has a faction of Kiss fans out there that are behind him, and they would want him to speak up. But, you know, it is what it is. But I don't think they're done. I mean, I think they're done as far as the makeup and everything, but there still could be like a Kiss convention or something like that, and some other chances where everybody could come together. But again, I mean, do you really think? I really don't even think Peter wants to be out there, and I think he's very happy with the way things are for him. And I don't know what Ace wants, but, you know, he can't keep, you know, doing the things he does and expect to get, you know, in good graces.
No.
So, and I don't know where Vinny's coming from. So
nobody knows.
Bruce is probably the only one that was the easiest to, you know,
approach,
be a team player. But then what happens if Bruce shows up and then Ace doesn't? I guarantee it, we hear the same comment. Well, I'm not happy because Bruce was the only one there. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. So it was best if nobody just showed up, you know? I mean,
yeah. So this is kind of a mission impossible.
Well, unfortunately for these guys, yeah. But, you know, somebody made the point of saying the same thing happens with Van Halen. Mm. They can't get everybody together to agree on anything either. No. So I'm not blaming Kiss. This is just musicians, people, and, you know, egos and, you know, being what it is. But in some ways, I'll say this much. They hurt us fans when they fight like this, because, you know, we would all like to see them, you know, up there at once, but we understand that it's just not possible all the time.
Yeah. But what does it mean to you that Kiss as a touring band is done?
Oh, I'm very, very disappointed, very sad, very melancholy feeling. I mean, I mean, when you're an 18-year-old boy, you see them, and then now you're a 67-year-old man. It's something you kind of grew up with, and you always knew it was always going to be there. I never stopped being a fan. I probably wasn't as intense a fan in sometimes as I were as another time, but, you know, I mean, it's not a happy feeling. But I remember this one saying that I saw on social media that I probably would use, which would say, don't be sad that it ended. Be happy that it was.
That's actually,
And that's probably the way I look at it, because we have all kinds of videos and things like that, and artifacts where we can enjoy. I mean, I've been up on stage with the band several times, and it's amazing every time I think about it, because they just don't let people do that.
No.
That's like a Joe Schmo from the crowd. I mean, yeah, you can get up there if you're Joe Perry or Rick Nielsen or Bruce Kulick, but I'm just somebody out in the audience. So when you get to go up there and do that and you get recognized as being a fan.
Part of the history.
Cool. Yeah. It's pretty cool. I mean, I have students that Google me, which is pretty funny. I mean, they have some questions, and they say, Mr. Starkey, I put your name into Google, and I got all this. And I said, it's true, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, it's kind of amazing.
And then you say, because they ask, so you know Kiss? No, Kiss knows me.
Kiss knows me, right. I'm an icon, remember? Icon.
Yeah, but did you watch the final show at Madison Square Garden, yeah?
Absolutely. I had a lot of friends there.
Okay.
Okay.
I had friends there, so I was watching it. But I really didn't think anything was going to change. I was surprised by the Avatar thing.
Yeah.
Other than that, it was, you know, it was what it was. You know, I mean, I thought maybe there was a crazy thing that maybe somebody like a Dave Grohl from Foo Fighters would show up. Somebody like that. I thought there would be a better chance of that than any former members. You know, I didn't think anybody was going to come as a former member, but I thought maybe, you know, other musicians might show up, maybe.
Yeah.
More of that than other Kiss people.
Because they had these interviews before the concert with the kids and Desmond Child and some other people. I mean, good opportunity to, you know, bring on some of the past members.
That could have happened, yeah. But of course, they have to come there to, you know, be on there.
Yeah. Yeah.
And like I said, how would it be if, I'm sure Bruce would show up, but what are you going to do about the other three? And I mean, like I said, I'm really not sure Peter even wants to be there, and that's fine. I think he's pretty much satisfied with everything's the way it is with him right now, and that's, I can understand that too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. But you were quite lucky because you saw them before Paul he got the flu or something right after your concert. Yeah,
it made me very nervous because I think we were all following social media by the hour, and I know some people in Toronto didn't get their show, and I think some people in Nashville didn't get a show. So I don't know that this is necessarily true, but I wouldn't be surprised if Paul sucked it up just for Indianapolis and said, you know what, come hell or high water, I'm going to be there. Mm. And you could kind of tell that he was maybe a little bit under the weather during the sound check.
Okay.
But overall, I liked the sound check as much as I liked the show because they're just stripped down and they're playing.
Mm-hmm.
There's no pyro. There's nothing has to be synchronized with the lights or anything because it's just a jam band. It's kind of funny to feel that way, but I could have been happy if they would have just played 90 minutes as the...
As a jamming band,
the sound check band. And of course people criticize, say, well, they play the same five songs. Well, yeah, but they're very tight with those five songs. I mean, you know, they don't miss a beat, and the sounds great. And you know, like I said, I enjoyed that as much as I did the show.
It's a nice experience. We did that in Berlin in the summer, the sound check, the three of us here.
Great.
Was it acoustic or electric?
Electric.
Electric, yeah.
Okay,
That
was the same five songs.
Yeah,
and,
probably, yeah. I would expect that.
There wasn't a lot of stage banter. I mean, I know they do a Q&A at the sound check. They didn't do much in mine, but they didn't want it counted where the guy says, who started the Kiss Army? And, you know, that's when that started rolling, because that was about the only thing they did. Well, I think Paul did talk about how many times they had played Indianapolis, which is interesting. But, you know, the first time I saw Kiss was in Evansville, Indiana. So Evansville had a lot of Kiss shows, too.
Mm-hmm.
And it's not a very big city at all. But it always worked when Kiss played there.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, I think Paul kind of sucked it up for Indianapolis, and he actually cut his finger during the show, which was kind of wild. I mean, I don't know how he cut it, but we were taking pictures, and you could see the blood coming from his finger, and he just kept playing.
Mm.
And eventually, he was able to get a Band-Aid on it to stop the bleeding. But he played pretty good. I mean. That was like 3/4 of the way into the show. I think at one time, I think he even showed it to Gene or Tommy or something, what had happened. but don't know if he cut it on a string or a strap or what.
That wasn't synced at all.
I mean, that was the real deal. So, you know,
yeah,
I liked my show. I liked. I think I was more surprised by the colors and the visuals, and I mean, even compared to the last time I saw them in 2012. I mean, like, here's a good example. Like when they're playing something from Rock and Roll Over, you see the Rock and Roll Over logo from the album behind him, and it's spinning and doing all kinds of, I mean, it was the little touches and things like that, or or the close-ups of Gene when he was doing his bass solo and the blood and all that. They just seemed to pay more attention to detail on that kind of stuff, and you know, which made it in really well. The lights were timed well, they were like lasers, and yeah, it was definitely a lot more fun to be there than to watch it on YouTube or anything like that, by far. And like I said, those are the best seats I'd ever had it for a rock concert. I've never been second row for anybody. Okay. So I was second row middle for Kiss, which was a good way to end it, I think, for that Trinity.
Well, to end it, yes, but let's talk about the Aviators. I mean, what's your opinion of that matter?
Well, I honestly think, my opinion is strictly as a guy off the street, just like any of you people. I think that somebody just came to them with the idea, and they liked the idea, and decided to run with it and see what happens. I'm not going to criticize it, because I criticized the Kiss cruise. I didn't think that would work. They're going, I said, oh, Kiss on a boat? That's not going to work. For 20 years. So I was wrong about the Kiss cruise. So the Avatars, it might work out. We'll see. But I still think we're going to see Kiss live somewhere, you know. Not necessarily, like I said, there will be no more tours or no more makeup or any of that stuff. And I think that's, I mean, I'm happy that they're home and enjoying their life and their families and kids. And I hope that's what they're able to do, because this tour has been going on since 2019.
Yeah.
And the more I just think about it, I thought, man, it must have been pure hell to go through all this and then the COVID protocols and all that. And, you know, it was a tough tour. So I'm kind of happy that it's over for them, at least in that respect. And, you know, we'll see. The Kiss fans are still crazy. I mean, I can't believe people are calling for Kiss expos and conventions. People just can't get enough of it. So I think eventually they're going to have to satisfy that. You know, when they did their own conventions in the 90s, I thought those were really cool.
Yeah.
I mean, you paid $100 and you got to be with them for 8 hours.
Yeah.
I mean, nowadays, that might be what, $500 or $600?
Yeah.
But it was still a lot of fun. I mean, I had somebody try to tell me one time back in the early 2000s that there was a talk of Kiss doing a convention or an expo and then doing a live show in that city. And of course, it never happened, but you know, those expos, if you guys have never been to those were cool.
I need to go there.
Yeah, we went to one in New York in 2017, I think.
Okay.
Yeah. Where Peter.
So that was done by a fan. I'm talking about the ones that Kiss did.
Yeah.
Where, you know, there was a Kiss trivia. They gave away a lot of stuff. They played Unplugged for a little bit. You know, they had a situation where they'd pass a mic around to the stands, the band would play, and you sang to the songs, and people videotaped them. It was pretty cool. And they really did do a Q&A. I mean, that Q&A probably was like an hour and a half, and they answered about every question that you wanted to ask. So, yeah, but, I mean, those Kiss conventions run by – well, and the Kiss conventions run by fans are good, too. But, like I said, if the band wants to – feel that need for the fans, and they could always go back to some Kiss expos and do a few of them, and walk away with some money and make a lot of people happy.
Do you think that it's something that will come now?
I think it can come. Yeah, I do. I don't think it's going to come within the year, but I think it could come. Sure.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't think they're completely done with everything, and I'm not saying that the Avatar thing won't work. I just think there's just a lot of things that have to be worked out of it before it, you know. And plus, we'll just see how well it works. At least, you know what's funny? They're not talking about Kiss 2.0 anymore.
No. I'm glad that's off the table, yeah.
So that's off the table, and so who knows? So 2.0 is not being talked about, and maybe the Avatar is the thing that will replace that. So we'll just have to wait and see.
Are you interested to attend such a show with the Avatars?
Mm-hmm, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
I want to keep an open mind. Like I said, yeah. I was wrong about the Kiss cruise. That's not going to boats and Kiss. That's not going to work there in the water. Come on. So, I'm always going to be attentive to anything they try to do.
Yeah.
I'm never going to say never. Now, Kiss 2.0, I don't know. Hmm. And then again, I would keep an open mind about that. I mean, because there are some good Kiss tribute bands out there, too.
Yeah, absolutely. Mm-hmm. But the opportunities for, what they can do with these Avatars are just, limitless.
It is limitless. The only problem with it with me would be that I'm not really into the superhero kind of thing. I was always into Kiss as a musical band.
Yeah.
Oh. And like I said, that's why I liked their sound check probably as much as I liked their performance, because I was always into the music part of it. So if they would have to lean more towards the music side of it than the fantasy side, maybe. I don't know. But, I've always said this. Kiss came too early for MTV because they were such a cool visual band. If they could have gotten into the thing of doing rock videos like other bands did, they could have done some really incredible rock videos because, like I said, they were a very visual band. Mm-hmm. But they came before MTV, and by that time, it was kind of, it wasn't quite the same. Mm-hmm. And then, really, by then, it was the 80s hair metal bands, and Kiss had taken off their makeup, so it just wouldn't have, it was just bad timing, But but I think Kiss could have done some really well. I mean, think about it. I think they've done some videos with the makeup on, like they did for The Elder.
Yeah, yeah.
But that's about it.
I Love It Loud, also.
Yeah, I Love It Loud.
Yeah. I was watching an interview you did with podcast Rock City now in December. Yes. Yeah. And you mentioned that Netflix should approach you and to do some episodes or movie about the Kiss Army.
I had a relative of mine who had some connections.
So you have been approached.
She suggested that I keep my YouTube thing going because she said that Netflix is always looking for content. Mm. And that kind of motivated me more to keep my YouTube thing up to date and current as possible and easy to access, because you never know, somebody might go through there and they may not necessarily be a Kiss fan. Like I've always said, you don't have to be a Kiss fan to enjoy the story of the Kiss Army, because just one of those bizarre stories that if you're a kid that grew up in the 70s, you kind of appreciate, because all the things that happened, the Kiss Army didn't start overnight. It was like 6 or 7 months of strange, crazy antics. Mm. And so, I would hold out hope that, who knows, maybe Netflix might be looking for content. But I also had people tell me that you're better off doing a book, because a book gets recognized before anything. And I've had too many Kiss authors kind of discourage me from that, saying that it's more trouble than it's worth. And not that they didn't like what they did, they just probably thought that it wouldn't be as difficult as it was for them. So, I don't know. So that's my motivation for keeping my YouTube site out. And I want to tell everybody out there to go check it out. There's all kinds of stuff up there. I get questions like, well, what does the radio station look like from WVTS today? And, or what is Rich Dickerson doing now? The district. And you can go on my YouTube site and find stories about all that stuff. And they're laid out pretty well. And it's just amazing that over almost 50 years, I'm still doing interviews. So I guess why not just put them all up there and see what happens?
But those interviews, did they stop during the 80s or?
They stopped during the 80s because basically my interest in the band had stopped because I didn't really start getting interviewed till maybe, my first print art interview was done by the Rolling Stone in 1975. And my first video interview probably didn't come till like the mid 90s. Mm-hmm. So okay. See, there was, and that's when, video recorders were more accessible and people were starting to have Kiss Expos, and I was invited as a guest, and people would want me to speak, and then they would videotape what I had to say, and everything went from there. And then before you know it, I'm getting all kinds of requests nowadays, like with this thing we're doing tonight. So, who would have thought I'd be talking to somebody from Iceland about 5 hours away about Kiss stuff?
So yeah,
that's how advanced it's become.
But talking about your YouTube channel, we are actually named Finland on your YouTube channel. You should change that, man.
Is it called Finland?
Our last interview, you say you're doing an interview with Kiss Army Finland.
Really? Something I said by mistake. Oh, okay. Because I have the logo up there as Iceland.
I know.
I have the logo.
Everything else is correct.
Okay. I'm sorry. Yeah. No, because never talked to anybody from Finland. I don't know. Maybe there probably isn't a Kiss Army Finland.
Yeah, it is.
Yes, there is. Yeah.
Oh, is there? Okay.
Yeah.
So there are armies everywhere.
So I guess there are. I've not talked to Mexico yet, though.
So since the mid-90s, you have been just doing interviews regularly? Or it started with the reunion thing Expo thing, yeah.
Pretty much started with the reunion thing when people started doing their own websites.
Yes, okay. Yeah,
people started doing their own websites, and I got to congratulate them. There were two guys. Mike Branville did like one of the first Kiss websites called Kiss Taku, and then eventually Mike went to work for Kiss.
Yeah.
And Steve Steerwalt did a really cool Kiss website called Kiss Freaks, which I always thought was neat because it took a humorous side to Kiss. And those two guys kind of helped motivate me to come out and be known more and, I guess, be more accessible. I know Branville took me to my first Kiss convention, and he said, "You got to come to this convention." And I said, "What is it?" And he said, "It's just a bunch of fans that are Kiss fans." And I said, "Well, is Kiss there?" And he says, "No." He says, "It's just you'll have to come and see what it is." And I went with him and Steerwalt to Chicago, and it was my first Kiss Expo. And before you know it, people are wanting your autograph, and I was totally foreign to that, So, I'm signing people's arms and things and shirts. And I had somebody say, "You need to take a picture of this because this isn't going to last long," So, once the social media stuff started coming up, then all of a sudden interviews started coming out. But, the newspapers lately are starting to do a lot because I always could figure out why Terre Haute didn't really totally embrace the fact that they were the home of the Kiss Army. I don't understand, never could understand why. So eventually their local TV and newspapers had started to, do things with me and all that. And of course, those things are up on YouTube as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, you were on the Indiana Business Journal just recently.
I know nothing about business either. Yeah, yeah. I call business. I'll do anything, Farmer's Digest.
Yeah. Exactly. So, are you ready for some short questions?
Sure. Yeah. Bring them off.
Yeah. I call this section Mr. Speed, so you have to answer quickly.
All right, I will try.
Are you ready?
Yes.
The best Kiss guitarist besides Ace Frehley?
Bruce Kulick.
Crazy Nights or Hot in the Shade?
Crazy Nights.
Paul's Live to Win or Gene's Asshole?
Ooh, Paul's Live to Win. I like that tour.
Yeah?
Did you see that show?
I saw the video that Lou Antonelli did to Win. I was not able to attend any of the live shows, but yeah, I thought that solo tour was good. I'm kind of kicking myself because he did play Chicago, and I just somehow didn't make it because it was on a school night.
Mm. Oh, right. Yeah. Yeah, it's a really good.
I thought it was a good album. But you know what? I like Gene's too, but I like a lot of Gene's stuff.
So do you like the Essel album?
I like it, but if I had to pick the two, I would pick Live to Win, without a doubt.
Okay.
Yeah, I really like a lot of the songs. I wish they'd have done some of Live to Win in concert, but somebody told me that just wouldn't happen because they don't do that stuff. I don't know. Somebody tried to explain it to me with the band, and I thought, you know, I said, I thought some of his stuff was really good.
Yeah.
What about Soul Station then?
I haven't given it a serious listen, but here's what I think's interesting about it, is the people I know that have told me that the stuff that, you know, of course it's cover stuff, but it's also stuff he's written. Mm-hmm. I've been told by people that the stuff he writes is actually better than the covers. When that's what perked my interest, so I thought, really? So I have not heard any of it. I've only seen the videos he's done. Mm-hmm. So, and that, you know, but as far as the album itself, I haven't heard it. I'm just, like I said, I'm intrigued by the fact that people said that you think you like the covers, but the original material is better than the covers. So that piques my interest.
Yeah.
Okay. Best solo album from 1978.
Ace Frehley.
Yes.
You chose wisely there.
Yeah.
The worst solo album from 78.
The what?
The worst.
The worst? Oh, Peter's.
Okay.
That's just my opinion. I'm sorry, Peter.
Yeah.
I think it's a fact that really.
But which one is better, Gene's or Paul's?
I like Gene's over Paul's. And I know some people swear by Paul's, but that's just me personally.
Mm. Okay, so it's... So it's Ace, Gene, Paul, and Peter.
Right.
Okay.
I like Gene's because there was a little bit of a Beatles. He had more of a pop sound to him, whereas Paul kind of sounded more like a Kiss record.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
And that's probably why I leaned toward Gene's on that one.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Yeah.
The best songwriter of the original four.
Oh. Well, some songs were written together. I would have to say Paul Stanley.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Paul Stanley.
Yeah.
Okay. On the scale 1 to 10, how good is Carnival of Souls?
4.
Yes. Totally agree. Totally agree. Maximum 4.
It's a guys, come on.
Maximum 4.
Okay. Next one. Tommy Thayer is
a wonderful guy.
Okay.
A wonderful guy. A class guy. Classy guy.
Yeah.
Sonic Boom or Monster?
Ooh. Sonic Boom.
Okay. The best biography from the original four?
Paul Stanley's, without a doubt. Paul Stanley's.
Okay, why is that?
Because... He actually has my name in it.
Okay.
Yeah, he put a picture. There's a page in there where he published the letter that Aquine Management sent to me on my birthday, telling me that they recognized the Kiss Army, and he put that in his book, which I thought was pretty. And I just think his book was honest. Now, on a side note, I thought Peter's book was very entertaining.
Yeah.
But how factual, I don't know. But there's a difference between the best one and entertaining. I mean, there's Gone with the Wind as a movie, and then there's a comedy. Yeah. Comedies can be very entertaining, but, you know, it's not Gone with the Wind. So.
But when you're... you have read all the books. Was there any time that, you know, oh man, this is just total bullshit? Something you knew better?
No, because there was nothing in there that related to me that I could say, I don't think there was anything in any of the books that I didn't think were not factual. Maybe some things were exaggerated, you know. But I don't think that anything that was total bullshit, you know.
No, okay. No. Okay. Okay, so Kiss meets the Phantom of the Park is what?
It's okay. It's entertaining.
Mm. Okay.
It's entertaining.
How was it when it's, it came out and it was new? I mean, you must have been excited.
No, I really wasn't, because by that time, you got to remember, Kiss was a very dark, mysterious, and dangerous band. And by the time that came out, it was like they'd kind of lost some of that, you know, I mean, I wanted to see what it was, but it definitely wasn't the Beatles' Hard Day's Night or anything like that.
So
you remember, I saw the band when there was a period where you didn't see them with their makeup on. They rarely ever spoke to you in concert other than Paul. So remember the first time they told me I was going to meet Kiss, I didn't want to meet them because they were just too mysterious and strange and whatever else. So by the time they did Phantom of the Park, some of that kind of wore off for me, you know.
Okay, yeah.
So they went overboard maybe by doing that movie.
Yeah, truly. Now, the Paul Lynde special was cool. I like that.
Yeah.
I like that on TV, but you know, the Phantom of the Park, no, I mean, we can still look at it today and we laugh at it, but, you know, even the band is probably a little bit, you know, I wouldn't say ashamed, but they don't brag about it, I don't think, a lot.
They laugh about it.
But what did you then think about, you know, the Dynasty... You know, the circus.
I like Dynasty. I thought some of the songs on Dynasty were neat. And the stage setup was pretty good. But that was, like I said, about the last time when I think Ace performed with them.
Yeah.
So that was probably like the last Kiss album that I bought when it came out. Because I really didn't follow them that much during the 80s.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
There were so many different musical things that came out during the 80s. You know, you had alternative music, and you had Springsteen, Prince, Michael Jackson.
Yeah.
There were so many other things that was getting your attention. And hair metal bands wasn't one of them.
So I mean, getting from this dangerous 1977 Kiss to the, I mean, what can we say? I mean, the circus around Dynasty. I mean, was that your feeling about it? Or...
Not as much, but you know, I can tell that, you know, Kiss had definitely gotten a younger audience, and the marketing was full blast by then, and you know, they'd lost some of their edge when they did the solo albums, because I was afraid they were going to break up. So the fact that they even came out with Dynasty kind of surprised me. But there are some songs on Dynasty I like. I mean, I Was Made for Loving You, X-Ray Eyes, 2000 Man. There was a good collection of songs that gave everybody a voice in the band. You know what I mean?
Yeah, absolutely, absolutely.
So what is the best Kiss live album and why?
Oh, the first one, because... if you listen to the first three albums and you grew up with them like I did, I mean, they were fine and there were some songs in there you liked, but until you heard those songs live, you didn't realize how different they could be.
Mm-hmm.
And whether they claim, you know, Kiss Alive was played with and or the all kinds of stuff that it's not particularly live, as someone who saw them a lot during those times, the album pretty much recreates the live experience for me and my friends and those of us that went there that originally started the Kiss Army. So Kiss Alive is and at that time nobody released live albums. There wasn't, you just didn't do that. I mean, they paved the way for Frampton Comes Alive and a lot of other live albums that eventually carried a lot of people. You just didn't do a live album. It wasn't, now I know Uriah Heep did a live album, but I don't know that it did all that much for their career. Kiss Alive was, and if it hadn't come out, there probably wouldn't have been a Kiss Army.
No.
No.
Mm-hmm.
No.
Okay. Eric Singer or Eric Carr?
Oh, Eric Singer. Probably because I know him. So I'm more fond of Eric Singer. I would follow Eric Singer if he played in a jazz band now. I mean, he sold me as a person that I don't care musically whatever Eric Singer does. I'll follow it. Okay. I mean, he's just that cool of a guy. Now, that's not to say that Eric Carr wasn't a great individual and a great member for the band. It's just not fair because I did not know him or meet him or even see the band when he was there. Mm-hmm. So that's my escape clause. Yeah. So I can only go by what I know.
Good answer. Yeah. Very good.
Yeah. But maybe we asked about this, or maybe I asked about it last time. Your favorite member of Kiss. Who is your favorite?
Well, if I had to pick, see, I should say Paul Stanley, because he called me, he gave me, you know, he was the one that spoke out for me recently. But in the early days, Gene was always the guy that always put me under his bat wing and made sure that I was taken care of, what hotel you were staying at, and I could bring my scrapbooks and go over Kiss scrapbooks with Gene, and it was like from one fan to another fan. I just always got the impression that he was more into the fan aspect, and like he was a fan of the band as much as we were. You know, I mean, to him it was like he was looking at it from our perspective. Now, you know, people change over time too. You know, so like I said, I can tell you that's what I will never forget from the beginning. But you know, nowadays, I mean, like I said, I never. In some ways, I'll probably say I never got to know Paul Stanley, like I thought I did. Like I knew Gene. Mm-hmm. And one other time, we were at an expo, and Gene asked me if I wanted to go on stage and talk and then do the Q&A with him, and I didn't even think that was even a possibility. So Gene got out of his chair and let me sit in his chair. So here I'm sitting up there with Bruce and Eric and Paul, and Gene's behind me because he gave up his chair to me, and I'm doing the Q&A with him. So I thought that was a really cool gesture. But I mean, maybe I have this weird thing that I think Gene always got a kick out of the Kiss Army story.
Yeah.
Because I also remember the time I was backstage in Chicago, like during the 2012 thing, and Kiss was doing a thing with Nightline, and Gene just saw me passing, and there were so many people in there, and he grabs me by the chin, and then grabs the ABC newsman, and he goes, "Tell him who you are," and Gene leaves, and I'm like going, "Blah blah 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 blah," but I didn't know what to say, because, you know, I think that's, you know, and they filmed me, I'm sure, but it didn't make the cut, but I just get this impression that Gene always got a kick out of the Kiss Army story. And even though I get teased about the thousands of people that surrounded the radio station stuff and all that, I think that Gene always kind of appreciated the fact that a kid that saw them as a struggling band thought enough of them to go back to his hometown and say, "These guys need to be on the radio. They're the next big thing."
Yeah.
And, you know, maybe that's just maybe me rambling on. I don't know.
So you don't have any picture of you with the band back from the beginning, the early days without the makeup, or?
No. That we took that very seriously.
Wow.
We knew that if you were allowed to party with the band, and John Hart was very nice about letting me bring people in. Because what I would do is if I had people that I owed favorite friends that I knew would not do something stupid like no drinking or drugs or autograph stuff or all that, if you just wanted to go in there and say hello and speak to somebody and you could get into a after party, you just knew there wasn't any way you'd want to bring a camera in there, because you respected the fact that they wanted their privacy. So nobody wanted to blow that. I mean, it was because I get a lot of criticism from people to say, "Well, I wished you had filmed more stuff." And I said, "Well, back then, you just knew not to run around with a camera." I mean, they hired people to do that. That's what the guy that took the pictures you see on my Facebook page. That was taken by Waring Abbott, who's a professional photographer. Mm-hmm. He toured with the band. That's what those people were for. That was their job.
Mm-hmm. Exactly.
Yeah. Respecting this opportunity was the thing.
Yeah, absolutely. So how is Mr. Evans right now?
I'm sure he's doing really fine. He and I haven't talked to him since all this KISS stuff. He's living in Jacksonville, Florida. I don't know if he's getting close to retired or not. I hear more from his missus than I do from Jay. And he puts in a little, you know, thank yous and whatever. I think he's enjoying the 5 minutes of fame, because I try to mention him whenever I can, because, again, if there was a KISS Army story, how could you not have his take in there? Because, again, we did it together, and that's just it was a funny thing. I don't think we ever seriously thought anything would become of it. We just, you know, I was doing it because I was unemployed, and he was about ready to enter college, so... Mm-hmm. You know, it was just something we did. I'll never forget when I first saw the band and I told him how good they were, and he laughed. He said, "You've never been to any other shows," and he was right. So, and then I think another good Jay line is somebody said, "Why did you call it the KISS Army?" And he said, "Because KISS fan club sounded too wimpy."
Yeah,
and
yeah.
You know, that's just a good Jay quote. You know.
Yeah. So you.
All right.
So,
I would be curious to know what he thought, or what he would have thought of this last show. I really would have been curious to know. But like I said, I wouldn't have gone to this last show if that guy hadn't been kind enough to have me tag along, because I just didn't think that I was going to be able to swing the money for it. I definitely couldn't have got second row seats, and I didn't expect to get a plaque or mentioned by Paul Stanley either. So... You know, all that was just more than I bargained for.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Icing on the cake.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And you always remember that we will welcome you here in Iceland when you arrive.
Yeah.
Wow, okay. Yeah.
With some special event with the KISS Army Iceland. Right, all President? Right.
Oh, okay, of course.
All right.
Yeah.
Wow.
So what's your the ultimate favorite KISS song?
Deuce.
Okay.
Get up and get your grandma out of here, because that really is the opener. And when you took somebody to see KISS, you had never seen KISS, not even on because there wasn't YouTube. It was always funny that was the song that hit them right in the face.
Mm. Yeah.
And then it comes out there and plays it like that. I mean, you're like, and they were always so loud. I mean, God, I mean, it was just crazy. And in some ways, I don't even think that I don't think that I'm deaf, but I don't think they're nearly as loud now as they were in 74 and 75. I guess they just did it, you know. And then you had festival seating, too, because then you could sit anywhere you wanted. So we were all squished up against the stage, and the heat from the stage would get you and everything. But Deuce was the call to arms. Get up and get – matter of fact, I think that was the first question I asked Gene when we were eating at a party, and I said, "What's the second line in Deuce?" And I think he said, "Pick up, because Jimmy's working hard this year." We couldn't figure that out.
No. So,
you're sitting by your favorite rock star, and instead of asking him anything, you're saying, "Hey, what is that second line in Deuce? We can't figure it out."
Yeah.
Pick up, because Jimmy's working hard this year. I mean, something to that effect. But, you know, that was our song, you know?
Yeah.
To this day, we really don't know what it means. I mean, you know, we know what nothing to lose means, but we don't know what it means. Right?
Yeah. Right, correct.
Yeah, right.
We don't know, you know.
Yeah. Perfect.
Yeah.
So, Mr. Starkey, thank you very much for joining the show once again.
You guys are funny. You make me laugh.
This has been amazing. Amazing.
It's a great honor. So yeah. Have you on the show.
Thank you.
Yeah, it is. Really, really.
Thank you.
And you just continue to, you know, spread the word, as you have been doing for the last couple of decades or something like that.
Yeah, yeah.
50 years.
And we will do our best as well.
Good.
And we look forward to meet you here in Iceland.
Okay, or you can come here too, you know.
We can come also, of course. Okay, Starkey, thank you very much.
You're welcome. Welcome
to the show. Jæja, Starkey.
Starkey, alltaf starkaður.
Alltaf starkaður.
Já.
Heldur að myndi heita starkaður eða hann veri?
Ég, svo það.
Já, líklega, sko.
Já.
Eftir nefnum. Starkaðsson.
Hvað myndi
mér? Vilhjálmur Starkaðsson.
Vilhjálmur Starkaðsson.
Já, af hverju ekki? Heyrðu, já, ég átti eftir að drekka hérna öðvöldsdrykki minn. Veitu, hvar?
Kannski Stallion, ég veit ekki.
Varst ána?
Já, getur.
Já, fósettin, þú tekur þetta þá. Ég rýf ekki drikkin á fósettan.
Já, gaman að heyra þeim síjónum og hérna, hann hefur nú alveg, hann ekkert að skýta út þetta avatardæmi, sko, hann alveg trúi á þessu.
Já, hann segir bara.